Hello, everybody. This is Shane DeBeer. I'm a partner in the Moscow and London offices, and I'm speaking to you from Moscow today. Wanted to welcome you to our presentation today, Oil and Gas Basics. And the topics today are engineering, procurement, and construction contracts, LNG, and mid and downstream issues. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Navpreet Atwal. First, she's going to lead off with EPCs. But before I do that, a couple of quick housekeeping notes. Important stuff having to do with CLE and CPD. So first of all, this session is being recorded for replaying. So if you could please put all your phones and devices on mute. Second, the program is eligible for CPD points from the SRA in the United Kingdom and is also approved for CLE credit in the states of California, New Jersey, New York, and Pennsylvania. There's application for approval, pending approval in Illinois, North Carolina, and Texas. If you want to get CLE or CPD credit for attending the program, if you could please just sign in and sign out and list the jurisdictions where you want to get the CPD or CLE credit. For those of you who are dialing in or those who will watch the replay later, an affirmation code will be announced to in the middle of the program for you to include that affirmation code in your form to get CLE or CPD credit. And then finally, each office has evaluation forms, and so we very much appreciate your feedback. And if you could take a minute to fill one out, we'd be obliged. So I think with that, I will get out of the way and hand the microphone over to my colleague to talk about EPCs.
Thank you, Shane. Right, this part of the session will focus on construction procurement and, engineering procurement and construction contracts. This is a brief agenda of what we will be looking at. So we will be going through the procurement routes that are common in complex oil and gas projects. There are two that are commonly used, the EPCM method and the EPC method. So we'll have a look at both of those and we'll briefly touch upon industry standard forms of construction contracts that are prevalent in oil and gas sectors. We will then take an overview of oil and gas projects. It will be interesting to see the illustration between project contracts and the impact that they have on EPC contracts in terms of bankability and risk allocation. We will then move on to have a look at EPC contract provisions that are commonly heavily negotiated. So as I mentioned, there are two common procurement methods that are used in construction contracts in the oil and gas sector. There are several others in the construction context, but for oil and gas sectors, you generally tend to see EPCM and EPC, and I'll come on to explain what each of those are. If we start with the EPCM delivery method, in its crudest form, the EPCM agreement is akin to a professional services contract. So what you will see is the owner or a project company that contracts with the EPCM contractor to provide engineering services. It also contracts to provide procurement and then construction management. In relation to the engineering services, this includes basic and detailed design. So the EPCM contractor will start with the basic requirements and complete them up to construction, build, design requirements. It will also assist the project company in procuring the construction contractors and suppliers that will ultimately build the facility. The overarching responsibility of the EPCM contractor is coordinating the management of the construction contractors and the suppliers. The distinction between the EPCM delivery method and the EPC method is in relation to the management. EPCM contractors only have management responsibility. They aren't responsible for project costs or scheduling. They stay with the proponent, so the project company takes the risk of project costs and programming up to completion of the facility. the proponent and the project company will ultimately try and flow down these obligations onto the construction contractors and suppliers. The EPCM delivery method, and Shane will talk about downstream construction projects shortly, that's where you will see the EPCM project delivery method, because those types of facilities are heavily engineered and they require a large amount of coordination. It's unusual to have an EP supplier that will do everything. So EPC, which is the common method that is that oil and gas facilities are procured, it's a much simplified procurement method. The proponent, which is a project company, could be an oil and gas owner, will contract with the EPC contractor. The EPC contractor provides the design. He provides the materials, all the equipment related to the construction of the facility, including commissioning the facility, right up until the time that he has to hand over the property, the facility. The EPC contractor, you may have heard turnkey construction projects, and the reason they're called turnkey is essentially because the EPC contractor hands over the facility to the owner, and all the owner has to do is simply turn the key. So the EPC contractor will have done all the commissioning, all the testing for the facility before it hands over. And the employer or the oil and gas company simply has to just flick a switch, and it can start operational process of the facility. Design and build, I've mentioned on the slide, if you can see, is commonly synonymous with EPC, but there is a distinct difference between design and build. Design and build and EPC are similar in the sense they provide the completed facility to the owner right from design. The difference with an EPC model is that it incorporates performance guarantees and specifications, which aren't familiar with design and build procurement methods. Just briefly to mention some EPC contractors, because there aren't that many in the market, you may have come across Bechtel, who is a very large US EPC contractor. In France, there is Technip. There is also AMEC in the UK. There is a small pool of EPC contractors, so this is a very high-tech procurement method, and owners will obviously tender very, very strictly in terms of providing tender documents and the facility. In terms of pricing, we will talk about the pros and cons of EPC method shortly. There are various pricing methods of this EPC route, which you don't see in EPCM. You can generally have a lump sum contract, and that's the preferred method by financiers. There's also the guaranteed maximum price, which creates a ceiling for the contractor in terms of how much he can actually spend. So essentially the EPC contractor will be paid his costs of actually producing the facility, but there'll be a guaranteed sum that he'll be entitled to. There are various pros and cons of the different methods. EPCM, it's a low-cost method. It gives the proponent a large amount of control, particularly over design and flexibility in changing that design. But it also means that he spreads the risks across the board with all the different components of the contractors. The disadvantage of that method is that the legal remedies are diluted. So if there's an issue with the facility, whether it be design or whether it would be workmanship, the EPCM contractor is not the only person that the proponent has the right to go to. There will be suppliers, there will be contractors. So that dilutes legal remedies, which isn't really favourable for financiers. The EPC method is a single point of responsibility. And if we would just flick back, you can see that the proponent, the project company, has only one contract to manage, and that's with the EPC contractor. So if there is a design fault or a workmanship fault, the owner simply has to go to one person. This means that they can just manage one contract. it's a delivery method that lenders are much more comfortable with because it offers bankability, and we'll talk about bankability in a minute. But the disadvantage of the EPC method is that it's expensive. And the reason it's expensive is because the contractor will take a large proportion of the risk. So the risk allocation is transferred to the contractor. Just briefly touching upon standard forms of building contract, the well-known international standard form of construction contract in oil and gas is FIDIC, the International Federation of Consulting Engineers. It's well-known in the industry, and the Rainbow Suite in particular is the one that's used. It's known as the Rainbow Suite because the different contracting methods are allocated colours. The Silver Book, for example, is the turnkey EPC conditions of contract, and it's used in power and process plants. The Red Book is used in building and civil engineering. It's more familiar to a pure construction build. The Yellow Book is more akin to a design and build project, and it's used in mechanical and electrical plant and design. As I said, the advantage is that it's well known in the industry, so financiers will be familiar with it, insurance companies will be familiar with it, the people that are involved in the actual construction, so your suppliers, your contractors, will be familiar with it. The risk profile in each of those changes, largely the format of FIDIC books are the same. The only difference is that risk allocation changes. So in the Silver Book, the contractor will take on a significant proportion of the risk. There are other international standard forms, and I've listed some of them. There are too many to list on the slide. The one that's used in the UK is the Logic Contracting International Standard Form. The standard forms are a great starting point, but they really need to be tailored for the project. And you will find that both lenders and owners will heavily negotiate, heavily amend the standard form contract. Because they amend it so significantly, it's not uncommon to have bespoke EPC contracts in the oil and gas. And currently there's a trend to move away from standard form use in the oil and gas sector to more bespoke contracting. So if we look at what a typical simplified oil and gas project would look like, and this is a project financed structure that you will see, and you can see the interlink between the EPC contract, which is sitting at the left, the left-hand side of the screen. There are various agreements here, which will all require interface. The three players that will be significantly important for the EPC agreement is the oil and gas supplier and the off-taker and the lender. The oil and gas supplier and the off-taker are relevant in terms of specification and performance issues, and that will interplay into the EPC contract. So for the supplier, they need to make sure that the right fuel and the feedstock are being supplied to the EPC contractor to ensure that performance guarantees can be met. The off-taker will have testing and commissioning regimes that need to be mirrored in the EPC contract. So there needs to be a huge amount of interface. The key player, however, in a project like this is the lender. And the reason that the lender is significant, has significant interest, is, as we heard yesterday, that the projects can run into multi-billion pounds, multi-billion dollar projects. The lender has a lot of exposure to the project. So they will want to ensure that they are satisfied with how risk is allocated in EPC contracts. They will have a large input in terms of risk allocation, and for them the project needs to be bankable, and that essentially means is that they want to ensure that they will recover their outstanding debt. So if we take a look at the key provisions that are usually negotiated in EPC contracts, and the key provisions that lenders will be specifically interested in, and they relate to quality issues, time and cost, and consequences of default. Quality is an issue in respect of risk allocation, because the EPC contractor will have given to it a basic design requirement from the owner, which will include initial design requirements, and it will also include subservice service, site condition surveying, like boreholes and the like. What the lender wants to see is the contractor taking full responsibility for these design risks. What they don't want is further down the line that something that the employer has provided, that the oil and gas company has provided to the contractor, is defective. So they want to ensure that the contractor takes entire responsibility and has the responsibility of investigating both the design and subsurface ground conditions. The warranties that are related to quality are heavily negotiated. There are a myriad of warranties in EPC contracts, and they largely overlap. You will have warranties in relation to compliance with specification. You will have warranties in relation to design, and design responsibilities for insurance purposes are usually at a lower standard of reasonable skill and care. And good industry practice, which is generally not defined or there's no legal definition, will need to be defined. Generally, the good industry practice warranty is, again, at the lower standard of reasonable skill and care. But what you will have sitting above all these warranties is a warranty for fit for purpose. The proponent, the company, would want to have the facility that operates. There is no point in constructing a facility through the EPC route that doesn't work. So what the lenders will want to see is that this fit for purpose obligation, this ultimate warranty, this absolute obligation, is not diluted by the various contracts, the various documents that make up the EPC contract. You will have documents, technical documents, that will sit behind the main terms that may include lesser obligations. If they include lesser obligations that need to be absolute, then you need to elevate them to contract level. You cannot have them hidden away in a technical document. So you need to constantly review, work with your engineers to make sure that all the warranties sit up front in the contract terms. Performance guarantees and liquidated damages are a key issue for both contractors and lenders. For lenders, they want to see that the facility output and efficiency and reliability of the facility, that it works. They will state minimum and guaranteed levels of performance criteria. The contractor will need to meet these. The minimum guaranteed levels essentially mean that the employer can take over the works, that they are minimal completed, but they can operate. The guaranteed levels is the performance criteria that the EPC contractor must meet. The EPC contract will contain a very detailed testing regime. It will set out the criteria that the EPC contractor has to meet and the levels of performance criteria that it has to achieve. If it fails these testing regimes, there is a mechanism in the contract for the employer to claim performance liquidated damages. And these performance liquidated damages will compensate the company, the oil and gas company, or the project company, for losses and or damages to the facility. These losses are generally loss of revenue, loss of profit, and they will compensate the company for a shortfall over the design life of the facility. There will also be a right, which the lenders would want to ensure is a right to reject the project, which is quite a harsh position, or they would want to reduce the price of the contract if it falls short of the minimum standards. The time of completion is obviously key for the off-taker, because he's obviously agreed to take on the output. And it will also be key to the lender, because it's at that point at completion that they will start recouping some of their debt. So time for completion is of critical importance to preserve the revenue stream. I mentioned defects liability period here only briefly, because it is important that when the facility is complete, there is a period where the contractor will be obliged to come back on site to rectify defects, and that period is known as the defects liability period. So the facility will be complete after the performance testing has been done, and there will be a period of between 12 to 36 months of when the contractor has to come back on site to complete any defects or remedy any breaches in the facility. There will be certain provisions within the EPC contract where the contractor will be entitled to extend that time. The lenders are obviously keen to ensure that the rights of the contractor to claim entitlement to extensions of time are limited. They try and limit these to the bare minimum. So force majeure is an example of where contractors want to ensure that there is limited liabilities to claim for extensions of time. So limiting contractors' right to claim time is essentially a matter of risk allocation. The lender will also want to ensure that the rights for the oil and gas company are much greater. So if the time for completion is not met by the contractor, the company can levy what we call liquidated damages, very similar to the performance delay damages in relation to failure to meet the completion deadline. The liquidated damages must be a genuine pre-estimate of loss that the company suffers if the facility is not completed by the target completion date. The liquidated delay damages are usually expressed as a per-day payment, and they are usually capped. I mention exclusive remedies because there's a misconception. Exclusive remedies are largely, LDs are largely considered as an exclusive remedy. They're exhaustive. However, there are occasions, and there have been case law, where liquidated damages provisions that the oil and gas company have sought to enforce have been null and void, largely because they are not a genuine pre-estimate of loss. So in order to ensure that the owner retains a right to claim for general damages for delay, you will see in international construction contracts a fail-safe clause. So these two are key to watch out, that if you want to preserve the right to claim general damages, you reserve that right by including a fail-safe clause and ensure that an exclusive remedies clause is not available to the contractor. Security is a key for the lender to ensure that if the contractor defaults, they have a right of recourse to either the contractor or others, and there are various methods and ways that the project company can protect itself against non-performance. You have performance bonds and guarantees, which we'll briefly look at, parent company guarantees, and there are various others. The key issue to remember is the financial security, particularly when it comes to the parent company guarantee. We have seen in recent years, particularly during the downturn, that the oil and gas companies and lenders have required specification of credit ratings of bond issuers and sureties providing performance guarantees. And in relation to the parent company guarantee, it's key to note that the financial covenants that will be provided are only good as those that are being given. So Dun & Bradstreet type tests on parent company guarantees are probably needed to ensure that they will meet their financial covenants. So bonds and guarantees are usually, the amount is usually a percentage of the contract price, and that's usually 5 to 15%. And they will be issued prior to mobilisation. The bonds and guarantees come in two forms, conditional and unconditional. The conditional ones require proof of loss, so the company will need to go and obtain either a court order or an arbitrary award to show that the loss has arisen. Unconditional bonds are on demand, so you can go straight to the bond issuer or the guarantor and request your money in the event of a default by the EPC contractor. There are various condition precedents that probably should be avoided. You don't want an overlap between the obligations and liabilities under the bond to affect obligations under the EPC contract. So you want to ensure that condition precedents are kept separate. Insolvency is not generally an event of default, so your bond or guarantee should expressly refer to insolvency and the ability to claim under the bond for a position of insolvency. You also have hybrid bonds and guarantees. They aren't conditional per se, but they may have conditions attached to them. For example, authenticating the company's signature before they claim on the under the bond, or they may require an engineer certificate declaring there has been a breach and the amount of the breach. From a lender's perspective, those, if they're looking for a pure on-demand, unconditional bond, those type of conditions shouldn't be included in the bond wording. And usually the bond wording is included at tender stage, so there is no, both the parties are aware of what terms lenders will require in relation for the project to be bankable. Limitation and liabilities are typically accepted in large EPC contracts. They are usually expressed as a percentage of the contract price, and that could be 100%, so that's quite a large amount. There are carve-outs from the limitation of liability. Liability for liquidated damages is always sits outside the limitation clauses. There is also statutory limitations which sit outside the limit of liability, and certain indemnities, particularly in relation to intellectual property, particularly if it's a new technology, they will sit outside. Indemnities in relation to environmental environmental warranties that have been provided. Indirect and consequential losses are always a highly negotiated area. Lenders don't like to see these being excluded. If the project fails, there is obviously going to be large loss of profit claims. So any indirect or consequential losses will need to be carefully worded if they are going to be included, to ensure that liability for loss and profit sits outside that exclusion. Insurance limits of indemnity are also key. You want to ensure that any insurances that the contractor has or is providing are commensurate with their limitation of liability. So if they've limited their liability to 100%, and that 100%, for argument's sake, is $5 million US dollars, you want to ensure that the insurance covers that $5 million. There is no point in having an insurance limit of indemnity of $2 million. Termination, very briefly, this is usually a last resort, but the reason that it's of interest to lenders is because they have a direct agreement, and I'm not going to flip back, but we would, if you look through your slides, the lenders will have a direct agreement with the EPC contractor, which means that they want to ensure that if there's any defects in the facility, they're able to claim directly from the EPC contractor, which means that they're keen to ensure the facility is completed. So they're not keen on calling upon these termination rights. But what will be key for the lenders is ensuring that the losses are recovered on termination, that mobilisation costs for the new contractor will be recovered from the outgoing EPC contractor. So just as practical tips, if you're involved in an EPC project, is early engagement of the lender. They're the ones that are going to drive whether the project is bankable, and they will have minimum terms that they want to impose on the EPC contractor. There are other interfaces with the off-taker that we saw and the supply, the oil and gas supplier, so you'll want to ensure that they are brought into the project negotiations early on. The EPC contract is generally a risk allocation contract, so you have to strike a balance between allocating risk to the contractor, but if you allocate greater risk, they'll obviously increase the price. So you need to consider that with your lenders, whether you have enough facility to be able to take on that particular contractor. And I think the other important thing is to ensure consistency in the technical documents. The EPC contract is made up of a number of documents. You want to ensure that any warranties in relation to the facilities sit up front. They're not hidden away in the technical documents. So it requires a great deal of negotiation, a great deal of coordination, not just with different proponents, but also integration of engineers within your team to ensure that you've got a balanced contract. That's all I have to say on EPC contracting, and I will pass over to Shane.
Thank you.
comment.
Navpreet, thank you very much. I think that was a very concise explanation of a very complicated subject and indeed complicated part of the project. I think that serves as a good lead-in. The first topic I'm going to talk about is, I'm just going to move here to the beginning of it. First topic I'm going to speak about is LNG, which a big component of which is these APCs to build the complicated infrastructure. And then following that discussion, sort of building on the conference yesterday, the presentation yesterday, I'm going to talk about some general midstream and downstream issues in the oil and gas industry generally that people that are new to the industry tend to have questions about. Starting out with LNG, what is it actually? LNG is important commercially, as we'll see, because it has changed the business in that it's a way to deliver gas, a product that could only be delivered by pipeline, to now be able to deliver it by ships. What LNG is physically is natural gas, mostly methane, but it can have butane and other hydrocarbons in it. And the way that it's able to be moved is that it's super cooled to the point that it condenses into a liquid, which is minus 162 centigrade or 259 below Fahrenheit. When it's cooled to that temperature, it condenses down so compactly that it only takes up 1/600th of the space that it does when it's in the earth, when it's captured in the earth. So that LNG, when it's being transported on tankers, constitutes an extraordinary amount of gas in a small space. And this, of course, allows it to be traded internationally, to be traded across the ocean. And indeed, there's also a coasting LNG trade that's grown up in Asia as well. For those people who are joining us by video or who will look at the materials, there's a picture there, an artist's rendering from photos made by the Cassini-Huygens space probe, looking at the surface of Titan, which is one of the moons of Saturn. And the reason that's relevant is because tests have shown that it is covered in seas and lakes consisting of methane and ethane. So a Titan, which is a bit smaller than the Earth's moon, is effectively a planet-sized LNG tanker. It's a planet that's cold enough that LNG stays in its liquid state and forms seas and oceans there. So some aspects, safety and technical aspects. Because LNG is a gas at Earth temperatures, it's environmentally friendlier than oil. Gas generally is less environmentally dangerous than oil because it doesn't carry particulate matter. Its density is less than the bits and pieces that are carried along by a liquid like petroleum, like crude oil. So when LNG spills on the ocean, you don't get an oil spill. It would be impossible to have an Exxon Valdez type accident with an LNG tanker because the freezing cold LNG, when it meets the ordinary Earth temperatures of the ocean, quickly comes to its boiling point, which is minus 250, and it boils away. It vaporizes into gas, which escapes into the atmosphere. Now, that gas is, of course, methane. It is a greenhouse gas, so that's not to say that it's not an issue if there's a spill of LNG, but certainly not an issue to the same degree as you had, for example, in the Gulf with the Macondo incident or the Exxon Valdez or oil spill generally. It's also not toxic because it's largely methane. Methane is something that's also a byproduct of biological processes. If Americans of a certain age might remember that Reagan, when President Reagan in the 80s claimed that climate change was largely due to cows, which was the subject of some mirth, not entirely untrue. I won't talk about the proportions of greenhouse gases that are attributable to cows, but it is essentially the same thing. Methane, as I say, is a biological process, and it is a detectable greenhouse gas that also comes from livestock husbandry. of course, LNG is very flammable. That's the whole point. And one big safety hazard of it is that when it's released, it can quickly drive all the oxygen out of an enclosed space. So that's why handling of LNG in the facilities can be quite dangerous and is quite a sensitive matter. Due to the expense of pipelines, small quantities of natural gas, for example, the associated gas, the wellhead gas that naturally occurs with crude oil, is oftentimes not economic. And in the past, and there's a picture here for those that have the materials, it was flared away. It was simply burned off. And people who may be driven by an oil field will have seen that sort of thing. They'll see of gas burning on an oil well. This gas is also known as stranded gas. And because LNG allows it to be, especially where stranded gas is close to a coast or close to an LNG liquefaction plant, it allows it to be feedstock and to be exported without the expense of a pipeline, which might make the gas uneconomic. In the United States, there's been, as I think most people know, there's been a huge increase in production of gas in shale deposits, which new technology has opened up that wasn't able to be there before. And what's going on in the U.S. is that whereas there were quite a few regasification plants in the U.S., either existing or being planned, that's to say plants which could accept an LNG tanker, warm the LNG back up into its gaseous state, put it into a pipeline, and feed it to customers, many of them are now being converted to go the other way around, to take gas back into those same pipelines from shale gas fields, liquefy it, and send it away for export. There's several dozen applications with the FERC, with the American Federal Energy Regulatory Committee, right now to either to convert these regas plants, these import plants, into export plants, or to build new ones. And so natural gas is gaining market share, not just in the U.S., but also all over the world, because it's very cheap. And also with the focus on climate change, as well as the general focus on reducing particulates in the air, it's much cleaner than coal. At present, coal is still the majority fuel, the fuel that's used by the majority of countries, and indeed it's the more than 50% of the share of electricity in the U.S. is also produced by coal, but natural gas is starting to dent that significantly. And that is part of what's driving the LNG boom, commercial boom. This is a chart, kind of interesting figures, that shows different continents, different regions of the world, not precisely geographical. They're actually carved up a little bit more just in terms of market, in that Africa is divided into sub-Saharan and then part of it's lumped in with the Middle East. And I'm also including Australia as part of Asia. And what it shows are a number of operating, on the left side, liquefaction plants, that's to say plants to export the gas, and on the right side, regas, plants to accept the gas. As you can see, the biggest number in terms of operating plants is for liquefaction is Asia, followed very closely by the Middle East. And in terms of operating plants, the regas facilities are overwhelmingly Asia, followed by Europe. Now, this obviously makes sense from the perspective of what regions are rich in gas and which are not. And this sort of goes back to the origins of LNG. The first LNG trade began between Indonesia and Japan, where Japan had high need for feedstock for utilities and so forth. And as an island country, it had inadequate supplies of oil and gas of its own. When gas was discovered in Indonesia, Indonesia at that point not being very industrialized and not having high energy use, this was the first sort of natural case where LNG made economic sense. And this was many decades ago. Obviously, the technology's improved and the prices have come down since then, but that's kind of where it got started. Other interesting aspect of it is under construction planned and proposed export plants are overwhelmingly North America. And that, of course, is largely but not entirely the United States. Canada and Mexico also have plants on the drawing board, again, due to shale gas. And this gas will be bound for both Europe and for the Far East, for Asia. So now moving into the specifics, the LNG supply chain. There's essentially five aspects of LNG that can be, each of these pieces of the LNG infrastructure can actually be controlled by different parties. And they all have to work in tandem with each other to move the gas from the gas field to the utility or to the residence or the end user. And so those are upstream, essentially just the production of the gas, liquefaction, chilling it down and putting it into the tanker, shipping, regasification at the country of import, and then finally marketing the gas, the offtaker of the gas. And LNG tends to have three basic project structures, although certainly these are not set in stone, and you'll see hybrids or mixes between these different project structures. First is vertically integrated, where the upstream producer also owns the liquefaction plant and may even charter the vessels and market gas on the other end, although typically even in a so-called integrated project, the upstream user would sell to a buyer, and the buyer or somebody else would control the regasification plant. So it's quite rare to see an LNG project which is owned from, you know, gas field to end user in LNG. The second sort of project you see is transfer pricing, where the owners of the liquefaction plant essentially arbitrage. They buy the feedstock from upstream producers, and then they resell it to the owner of the regas facility, to the importer. And then finally, tolling projects, where the LNG liquefaction plant, the owner, operates as a sort of a utility, doesn't take title to the gas at all, but simply charges a toll, a volume toll, for services to liquefy it and load it onto tankers. So in an integrated project, just to give a very rough example, the ownership and the contractual matrix might look something like that. You would have owners that have their own upstream production, they have their own interest in the upstream. United States, that could mean literally that the owners own the mineral estate, so they actually own the gas in the ground, something discussed yesterday, which is that the United States differs quite a bit from other countries in the world in that private ownership of the hydrocarbons in the ground is something that's not only permitted, but is actually the majority, you know, the prevailing system. And so as owners of gas, as owners of that feedstock, they would directly own the gas producing entity, the production company, and then typically there would be a special purpose vehicle which would act as the seller of the gas, and that SPV within the context, for example, of project finance would also own the liquefaction plant and might indeed own or at least charter the ships, the tankers that would actually deliver the gas elsewhere. Then what's more typical would be the purchaser would be the party that would own the regasification plant at the country of import that it's shipped to. The purchaser would also own storage facilities or otherwise have access to storage facilities. Storage facilities, incidentally, don't necessarily mean metal tanks sitting next to the plant. In large quantities, storage can also be geological structures, which is to say, underground caves and structures that are where gas can be put into and released from, which are essentially gas fields that have been depleted or other structures, underground structures, which are capable of holding gas and keeping it. And then finally, that'd be the end user. With LNG, the end user, because of the volumes involved, would typically be utility. But in some rare occasions, it can be brokers and arbitragers as well. So just to go briefly through the kind of documentation involved, and the documentation that would be involved for the whole value chain of an LNG from upstream all the way to the buyer. These deals are very complicated, and you know, the documentation would run into volumes and volumes. But the if we exclude the technical documentation and just focus on the legal documentation, the upstream, and then for those of you who might have listened in on the presentation yesterday, is the same sort of upstream documentation that any producer of oil or gas would have. In the U.S., that would typically be a mineral lease, an oil and gas lease. Would also include a joint operating agreement to deal with how that is produced, or in the U.S., that would be called a working interest agreement, and then a shareholders agreement for the venture that actually owns or is able to get title to the gas, for the parties to regulate their relationships. Typically, there could be issues of cash calls, there could be issues of drag along and tag along, and the interrelationship between the parties. Okay, liquefaction. Fortunately, I don't need to talk about the EPCM contract, since Navpreet did a very good job of explaining that complicated subject. And as you've heard, that's a very complicated piece of the puzzle. In addition to that, the liquefaction plant will also require an operating agreement with a designated operator. There are a number of specialty companies that do that, that operate LNG liquefaction plants. Financing agreement, which can take a number of forms, typically would be project financed, and pipeline agreement to actually move the gas from the upstream into the liquefaction plant, and then berth and land lease agreements. In other words, the port infrastructure, the agreements required to have control of the port infrastructure to ship it, to export it. Then there's the shipping aspect of it, and I'm going to talk a bit about shipping following this as part of the sort of midstream discussion. But essentially, you have a charter party, which is the party, which is the agreement for the use of a ship, and there are different kinds, and I'll talk about those in talk about the midstream. Insurance agreement, obviously, and because there are limited number of LNG tankers in the world, there's not a market for them the way there is for oil tankers, because this is a relatively new industry and it's a growing industry. You typically have to have your LNG, if you're going to own or control the LNG tankers, you need to get them built yourself. So you need a shipbuilding agreement with a shipyard to do so. And then, of course, if you have a shipbuilding agreement and you're building a large piece of infrastructure like that, you need a ship finance agreement to go with it. So there's a heavy dose of admiralty and maritime law involved in LNG projects. Getting to the downstream, typically for downstream agreements, it would be an EPC agreement rather than an EPCM agreement. Not universal by any means, but that tends to be the trend. And in addition, there are more infrastructure-related agreements involved in a regasification plant than there is with a liquefaction plant. This also depends on, again, where the parties stand in relation to the various infrastructure, whether the buyer or the seller is the party that actually owns the regas plant. And as I said, it typically tends to be the buyer. So there'll be an agreement for using the terminal, which is typically specifies output and specifies the disposition of the output. Terminal finance agreement, again, an operating agreement. And again, there tend to be specialized contractors that are able to operate LNG regas plants. That's, as you can imagine, that's a fairly limited universe these days. Obviously, you need to have a lease agreement for the land. yet again another throughput agreement or pipeline agreement to move the gas from the regas terminal into storage of some kind or another or onto the end user. And then finally, gas sales agreement. Gas sales agreement are also very specific and unusual because not only does gas pricing tend to be rather complicated, but the mechanisms for measuring gas also have to be very set out in great detail in gas sales agreements. So moving on from LNG to just talk about just some general thoughts about the midstream, some basic issues that come up whenever you have an oil and gas deal that has any midstream component to it. Again, midstream as opposed to upstream, that means moving the petroleum, the oil or the gas, from the field to the refinery. So essentially from the gathering from the gathering pipes at the field down to the point at which the ownership or the title transfers for something to be done with it, for it to be processed or what have you. Because oil is liquid at room temperature, oil is very easy to transport, and there's essentially almost any form of transportation. There's an industry that moves oil that way. So not just pipelines, but trucks, barges, rail, tanker, unlike gas, which other than pipeline can only be moved by LNG ships. The U.S., has one of the most extensive pipeline networks in the world for both oil and gas. So the midstream tends to focus in the U.S. on that, although with the increased growth in production of oil and gas in areas that it wasn't produced before, specifically North Dakota, to some extent Pennsylvania, to some extent South Texas, particularly the shale producing areas, rail movement of oil by rail has become much more common now than it used to be, has grown, simply because the demand has now outstripped the supply in terms of transport capacity. So oil and gas pipelines are, as you can imagine, heavily regulated. In most countries in the world, the United States is the outlier because in most countries of the world, it's common for the state or the crown to either own them outright or at least to own a controlling or at least a veto interest in the infrastructure. Not surprising, it's considered to be strategic infrastructure. It requires enormous amount of investment. Of course, there are issues of gaining easements and property rights and so forth in order to build pipelines. So some examples, in Russia, for example, a state-owned company called Transneft is responsible for moving 90% of all Russian oil through its pipelines. And the Gazprom, which is the primary gas company of Russia, a company that is said as an upstream producer to control 25% of all the gas on Earth, is controlled by Gazprom. And in addition to its huge upstream reserves, Gazprom has a similar degree of control over Russian gas pipelines. So Gazprom is also the transporter for the majority of Russian gas. Not all of it. And there are, Novatek is a Russian company, for example, which has recently risen in the gas sector in Russia. That's not Gazprom, but nevertheless, that's overwhelmingly Gazprom's playground, both producing and shipping gas in Russia. An example of a more hybrid type of pipeline ownership structure is the Dolphin Gas Pipeline. This carries gas from Qatar to the United Arab Emirates in Oman. It may seem unusual to people, the idea of a gas pipeline in the Middle East, and especially a gas pipeline that goes to Abu Dhabi and to Oman, since we think of the Gulf countries as all being exporters of oil and gas. In fact, that's not necessarily true, and the gas is not necessarily where it's needed. Dubai, for example, is not really a huge exporter of oil or gas, Dubai being one of the seven of the United Arab Emirates. However, because of its growth and its thirst for energy, the Emirate of Dubai as well as the Emirate of Abu Dhabi are both large users of gas because they're large users of electricity. And so this gas pipeline, Qatar, is another enormous gas producer, one of the largest gas producers in the world. And so Qatar sells this gas on to Abu Dhabi and Dubai, and then on down to Muscat in Oman to supply the local needs there. So this is for power generation and for local needs. That pipeline is part-owned by Abu Dhabi, the government of one of the seven emirates, but as well as having a minority, both Total and Occidental have a minority stake, so both foreign companies. The United States, as I mentioned, is the outlier. In the United States, there's a multitude of private pipeline companies, and one of the most important of those companies is Kinder Morgan. Kinder Morgan was built on the assets that were bought from Enron. Again, for those of us of a certain age, and especially Americans who remember, Enron was an energy company that went bankrupt in a rather spectacular way. And a lot of the focus at the time of the Enron bankruptcy was this view that it was a company that largely traded in derivatives of oil and gas, and that's what brought it down. But in fact, what Enron started its life as, and what Enron indeed, even at the point of its bankruptcy, was among other things, a controller of an enormous amount of infrastructure. So Kinder Morgan, based on those Enron assets, now controls 84,000 miles, which is 135,000 kilometers of pipelines, and owns over 180 storage units for gas. If you want to transport oil or gas, it would seem that this would be a very simple contractual model. It's just moving molecules or moving crude, you know, from one place to another. Indeed, there are not that many complex issues that go with the midstream. There are a few that are worth mentioning. The two agreements that are typical for moving oil or gas or pipeline or throughput agreement and a storage agreement. Throughput agreements tend to work on a tolling basis, especially in the U.S. where you have a private party that owns a pipeline, which is different than the private party that's in the upstream. So you pay on a volume basis. In some jurisdictions where there are multiple grades of crude or whether there's differing grades of crude that are going into the same pipeline, and we'll talk about the grades of crude a little bit further on, the lower and higher value oil can become mixed in the pipeline. Some oil is worth more than other oil, depending on certain qualities. If that happens, then some of the people at the other end will be getting oil that's less valuable than what they put in, and others will be getting a windfall. And so this is dealt with a system called a quality bank. Essentially, it's a system of measurement at the point where the oil goes in, and then quality measurement at the point where the oil is drawn off by the buyer or the receiver at the other end, with an agreed set of compensation if the oil turns out to be more sour or if it has other quality defects or benefits compared to what was put in at the sending end as opposed to the receiving end. Another important commercial point is that in an era of low oil and gas prices, storage itself has become an enormous and quite a profitable business. And indeed, at this moment, there is a shortage of storage, oil and gas storage facilities globally, such that there are some tankers, oil tankers, which have actually been taken out of being mothballed and been refitted to simply serve the purpose of sit stationary in port and store oil and gas. Some of this has to do with the fact that some countries have strategic reserves, and in a period of low prices, they buy up additional oil. Some of it has to do with trading, where people are buying up oil and gas and sitting on it for purposes of reselling it under forward contracts. And some of it is just that the oil continues to get produced and may not all necessarily find a buyer. Another important aspect of dealing with, especially with gas, but not only, are take-or-pay clauses. Because pipelines are require such huge capital requirements, because gas prices are so volatile, both gas purchase and throughput agreements tend to have the take-or-pay clause or something analogous to it. And take-or-pay clause works pretty much as the name suggests, which is the buyer agrees to buy a certain percentage of all the gas that a producer can produce, and it must pay for it whether or not it has a market for it or whether or not it can take it. So what happens, and this is the subject of a lot of litigation, not just in the U.S., but in many jurisdictions, if the buyer simply doesn't have storage for it, buyer doesn't need it, or doesn't have a market for it, can the seller sell it elsewhere? What about the pipeline company? If it's a take-or-pay situation, once the gas or the oil is tendered and the buyer says, no, sorry, I can't take it, it's agreed and it's understood that they'll pay, you know, whatever the penalty percentage is, payment for the gas or the oil they didn't take. But does that give the pipeline company the ability to reallocate that capacity or even reverse the flow of the pipeline in another direction? So these issues have fueled litigation almost as much as power plants have. So now, moving on to what I alluded to earlier, grading and pricing. So we're kind of moving from the midstream into the downstream a little bit. You've probably heard various terms used in reference to crude oil, and certainly in crude oil contracts, purchase and sale agreements, you'll see reference to these things. Quality of crude oil basically is how much useful product can be obtained at the refinery, and it varies quite significantly. And the value may be greater or lesser depending on what the refining capacity is in a particular country or that a particular buyer has, or what the changing needs of different products that can come out of the crude oil. So one factor is it's API gravity. And API stands for American Petroleum Institute. And this is a measure of density. And less dense oil, what's called light oil, is easier to refine. And it also tends to refine into a better mix of products. By better, what I mean is fuels that tend to bring a higher price. So if you ever see an API gravity quotation for crude oil, these are the numbers to look for. If it's 34 or above, that's classified as light. That's more valuable. Medium, which tends to be the majority of crudes in the world, would have an API gravity between 31 to 33. And then anything that's less than 30 would be deemed to be heavy oil, which is not only is it less valuable, but indeed, there are some refineries that that can't handle it. Although it must be said that the opposite can also prevail, which is to say a country which produces a lot of its own crude might have a lot of heavy oil, and the refineries there might be geared towards it, and they might actually have an issue with taking light crude because their refineries aren't geared to that. And then the other key quality indicator of crude oil is its sulfur content. Heavy sulfur content renders the oil less valuable because of the refining costs involved, and it's called sour. The reason being, for anybody who's ever encountered any large quantity of sulfur, smells like rotten eggs. With really sour crude oil, very sour oil, this is something that can be literally detected by the human nose. In fact, this is also turns out to be an environmental problem that a lot of refineries face, refineries that have to deal with sour crude, because the smell is also a factor that that can be regulated and can be very expensive to deal with. So by contrast, low sulfur crude oil is called sweet oil. So crude oil is very widely traded, the market, in order to trade it, uses various benchmark grades. And the grades are supposed to represent not only the region that it comes from, where the oil is produced, but also they're supposed to generally have a consistent API gravity and consistent level of sweetness, as the case may be. Now, this isn't to say that you can simply put in a contract, well, I'll have, you know, a million barrels of Brent and leave it at that. You would still need to specify what the API gravity is and what the whether it's sweet or sour. But nevertheless, these benchmarks for purposes of pricing and market quotations carry with them some idea of a given quality of a given type of oil. Three that are most widely known and most widely traded are Brent, WTI, and Urals. Brent comes from the North Sea, largely from the North Sea, to some extent further afield. It's the name is kind of a curiosity. It's named after the Brent goose because Brent comes from one of Shell's, originally came from one of Shell's oil fields. And Shell's nomenclature in the North Sea is they name all their oil fields after birds. So Brent could have just as easily have been like duck or cormorant or something like that. But Brent is the field that where Shell started its trading operations in the North Sea, and so that's why we call it Brent. West Texas Intermediate has a lighter API gravity, it's an API of almost 40, and it's sweeter than Brent. As the name suggests, it comes largely from West Texas, but not entirely from there. It's traded in particular out of a storage hub in Cushing, Oklahoma, which is actually some ways away from, that's not in the Panhandle, that's actually quite a ways away from West Texas. The other heavily traded, especially in my part of the world, heavy traded oil, is Urals. There's actually not very much oil produced in Russian Ural Mountains, and the oil that is produced in the Urals tends to be quite sour. Very significant volumes of oil are produced next door in Western Siberia. And this grade is a standard for a blend of Russian crude that's generally sold on into Europe. So it's actually heavier and more sour than Brent is. Largely because it's a blend and it mixes in some crude oil that it mixes in the Urals crude oil. Western Siberian crude without the blending actually tends to be closer to Brent in terms of quality. Interesting transaction took place not long ago. A small publishing company, well, actually not very small anymore, but a publishing company called Argus Media recently sold for several billion. And somebody familiar with the deal was quoted as saying, data about oil markets now seem to be worth more than the oil itself. And there's some merit to that. Oil is such a widely traded commodity. It's traded on so many different exchanges. It also carries in its wake such a huge number of derivative instruments that the publishing industry that tracks oil prices has become actually quite a significant industry in its own. So Argus and then its American rival Platts published market prices for these different grades, and these published quotations are the basis for all oil and gas contracts. They will typically quote prices that will be a particular grade, Brent with a specific gravity of such and such, and then with a discount or premium above whatever the quoted price is at the time of delivery. So the largest exchanges that trade oil as well as, well, petroleum products generally as well as derivatives are Chicago Merc, NYMEX. There's a fully electronic exchange now, the Intercontinental Exchange, and then in the Middle East, the Dubai Mercantile Exchange, in India, the National Commodities and Derivatives Exchange, and then the Tokyo Commodity Exchange. Those are the largest brokers, rather exchanges, for oil trading. Talked about shipping in the context of LNG, especially in the context of crude oil as well. The specialized LNG tankers are, as I say, sometimes a world unto themselves, and frequently a new LNG project will also involve building LNG tankers in order to actually service the LNG being produced. In the world of crude oil, because production of crude is waxed and waned over the years, there's actually an enormous fleet of crude tankers that exist in the world. This is governed by ordinary maritime law that controls, the shipping of any other cargo, essentially. As I mentioned before, the legal arrangement for hiring a ship is called a charter party. And there are two essential types of charter party. There's a bareboat charter, and this is where the party that needs the vessel, employs the vessel, has possession and full control of the vessel. So that means they supply the crew. The captain of the ship answers to that party, the party that's chartering the vessel. And most importantly, they have full operational, legal, and financial responsibility for the vessel. So they simply pay a charter hire, and the crew, the fuel, the insurance, the port fees, etc., those are all at the expense of the charterer. The other common type of charter is a time charter. In this case, the charterer hires the vessel for a specific time, and it directs its route. It says, go to port A, take on X tons of crude, and then deliver it to port B. But it's the ship owner that manages and crews the vessel. So here the charterer still pays the fuel, which is a term you see in shipping is called bunkering. That's the fuel for vessels, as well as the port charges. And they will simply pay a daily hire rate to the owner. Another term that you see in shipping is demurrage or laydays. If the ship is delayed, depending on the circumstances, the charter may be liable to pay for those extra days. And this is something that's laid out, is negotiated heavily and laid out in detail in the charter party. What constitutes laydays or demurrage, where the charter has to pay, notwithstanding that the ship could be sitting at anchor off port and not doing anything and not going anywhere. The terms of how title passes and the shorthand terminology that's used to describe what's to be done with cargo, where cargo passes, are defined by a series of terms that are defined by the International Chamber of Commerce called Incoterms. The actual document that describes Incoterms is actually a very small pamphlet. It's about the size of Zagat's restaurant guide, if you're familiar with that. The reason that it's able to be so short is because these terms have been defined largely through case law and through international practice through centuries and centuries of use. To give an example of a few that are most commonly used in shipping oil, FOB, you've probably heard that, FOB and then the name of a port. So FOB stands for free on board. And what that means is that the seller who is shipping the cargo, shipping the oil, bears all costs and risks until the oil is loaded onto a tanker at the designated port. So if it spills on shore, that's the seller's problem. It's the seller's loss. If the ship, leaves the dock and there's an explosion, that's the buyer's problem. That's essentially how FOB works. The seller, however, must pay for export clearance, because that's considered part of it being loaded on board. But the buyer pays the charter party hire and all the costs thereafter once the oil is actually in the tanker. The contrast to that is DES and then the name of the port. DES means ex-ship. And what that means is that the seller is responsible all the way until the ship docks at the buyer's port. So if the seller is in the Middle East, for example, and the buyer's in Europe, this means that the seller bears the risk until the cargo is actually unloaded in Europe. Whereas if it's FOB, it's the buyer's risk and the buyer's expense, for example, from Kuwait. The other term that you see frequently in oil and gas transactions, DAF, delivered at frontier. This is particularly used for rail shipping, which basically means as soon as the rail tanker cars clear the border of whatever country they're headed to, that's where title passes. And that's also where the financial responsibility typically ends. And then there's CIF, and then the name of a port. CIF stands for cost, insurance, and freight. In this case, the seller pays the shipping costs, the shipping costs all the way to the point where it's imported to the destination of the cargo, but the title and risk pass at the port of export. So if the ship sinks, the seller still has to pay the charter hire, but the loss of the cargo is the problem of the buyer. And then finally, moving on to the last stage, refining. Crude oil is, unlike gas and unlike LNG, which is very simple and which consists of, you know, one or two elements, crude oil is actually a very complex mixture of hundreds of different types of hydrocarbons. As we saw discussing grades, you know, different crude oil can contain, you know, very different mixtures of various different elements, hydrocarbons in them. And so refining is basically the process of separating those different elements out into various usable things. And the terminology that's used in the business is fractions. So the different products that come out of a barrel of crude are called the fractions or products. Hydrocarbons obviously can take three different forms: gas, liquid, or solid. And all three of those can be extracted at a refinery. So methane, gasoline, or asphalt. And here is a chart showing a typical mix for refining a barrel of Brent. So the first aspect, or the lightest fraction, if you will, petroleum gas. So this is essentially those gases that make up LNG: methane, ethane, propane, and so on. 6% of a typical barrel of crude, when it comes out the other end of refinery, will come out as naphtha, which is a solvent, which is sold for industrial uses mostly. What refiners think of as a really valuable part, and what, of course, consumers and end users think of the most, is gasoline or petrol. Typically, only 21% of a barrel of crude oil actually can be rendered into gasoline. That's a typical fraction from a barrel of Brent. And then kerosene, which in the early days was considered to be one of the more valuable. In fact, originally, when oil was first drilled for and first produced and first marketed, it was largely in order to get kerosene out of it. Kerosene today is used as jet fuel, but at the very dawn of the age when this industry came into being, it was used to light lamps. And it was considered a very cheap alternative to whale oil. And indeed, it put the industrial whaling business largely out of business. Diesel fuel typically is the largest fraction. As I say, from a typical barrel of Brent, it'll be 36%. Diesel is also, although it is dirtier than gasoline, this issue has been in the news lately with Volkswagen's difficulties in the United States about diesel emissions. It's also a richer fuel, so it tends to be more calories per liter, as it were. And this, again, is the highest fraction that a barrel will get. And then there's fuel oil, which tends to be even a bit dirtier than diesel. That's about 19%. And that's typically used for bunkering and also for various industrial purposes. In some places, including the United States, it's also used for heating oil, particularly in the Northeast United States. And then finally, the other 9% is a whole variety of things, including some solids. that are left over at the end. Coke, asphalt, tar, waxes, and materials of that nature. And the business of refining, it's traditionally, and for the most part still, traditionally has been, and for the most part still is dominated by the majors, Exxon, Shell, BP, and so on. However, more independent companies have begun to move into refining in recent times. In the U.S., about half of all refining capacity is owned by non-majors. This is somewhat unusual because of all the aspects of the petroleum business, refining is probably the least attractive commercially. It's a low-margin business. It's a risky business. It involves a high investment into infrastructure. And the reason the majors stay with it is because it's an integral part of an overall very profitable vertically integrated business. And so this is a part of the business that they like to control. And with that, it looks like we've probably got some time for questions. And so that is the end of the substantive part of my discussion about midstream and downstream issues as well as LNG. Since we jumped right into it, I wanted to open the floor for questions not only to myself but also to Navpreet about EPC contracts. And we'd be very happy to answer any questions that you have.
Hi, this is Alex DeGramont in Washington. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Well, first of all, I thought it was just fantastic. I mean, you covered an amazing amount of ground in a really concise and interesting way. So thank you. It's terrific.
Well, thank you.
And maybe you covered this a little bit yesterday. Unfortunately, I missed yesterday's session. But I wonder if you could talk a little bit about our practice and whether we focus on particular segments of the market, whether it's lenders or project companies or producers, or whether we look for business from all of those.
good question. We do indeed. As you know, we have an energy and natural resources group within the firm. That group is spread out. It is indeed a global group. With lawyers in the group in the U.S. as well as significant presence in Europe and in the Middle East, especially in the Dubai office, naturally. Because the nature of the business is different from place to place, I would say that in the U.S. we do very little downstream work, and we tend to represent lenders. And we tend to also represent private equity that has some interest or another, you know, at some point in the value chain. Overseas, because the nature of the industry is different, I wouldn't say that the industry is mature in the U.S., but I would just rather say that it's different overseas. We represent both producers, including majors. We represent Total, for example, in Kazakhstan and the Middle East. We represent national oil companies, which is something I discussed yesterday. It's essentially a state-owned oil company like Petronas of Malaysia. And then we represent a whole variety of other players in the market, independent companies. We represent lenders overseas, project lenders, and indeed even service companies service the industry, the manufacturers and project services providers. On the EPC side, I can let Navpreet speak to that, but I know from our practice here that we represent both employers and contractors, and indeed sometimes lenders. Although this wasn't in the oil and gas business, but a very recent large arbitral litigation that we had in the London office essentially involved exactly that, an EPC dispute. As you can imagine, with agreements that are that complicated and with that much money at stake, the litigation tends to be a very extensive and complex matter.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
questions. I'm just going to announce the CLE code if we have participants who are participating by teleconference, or if you are viewing the recording and requesting CLE or CPD credit, please note the following code on your affirmation form. GAS, GAS7380. Again, the code is GAS, GAS7380.
Okay. Well, with that, I want to thank everybody again for joining us. It's as I mentioned, it's my yesterday's session. Very interesting area of law, and something that we do a lot of at Dechert, and both internally and externally. I would encourage anybody that has any questions, please, you know, do feel free to follow up. I can talk your ear off on this subject or send me an email. And I imagine that Navpreet will second that. And thank you again for attending.